Good morning. Am I on? Okay. All right, we are going to do communion this morning. So, we're just going to pass out the elements, but I'm just going to spend a little bit of time. Thank you so much. That's fancy. All right. Well, it's a testament of the Lord's mercy that I'm standing here right now. I thought I'd get further. Okay, here we go. I just want to paint a picture of the garden scene. So I'm going to take you to the garden scene here. So Jesus is in the garden. He's called out his disciples, Peter, James, John, come and pray with me. Come and watch with me. And he calls them into the garden. And they are, I can't look at my mom. It makes me want to cry. I love you. So the breeze is moving through the trees. Jesus has gone away and he is spending time with the Father now. Okay. But something happened in that moment. Mark 14 says that Jesus became deeply distressed and troubled. These two terms are actually extremely difficult to translate from the Greek. Distress roughly translates to sudden shocking awareness. And the word troubled can't really even be put into English. It means to the point of sheer terror. So he's there, he's praying, and something comes over him where he is just suddenly shocked and aware and in terror. So what happened here? I believe that the Bible says that God is the Son, or that Jesus is the Son of God. Yes, but he's also the sinless man. And I believe that in this moment we're seeing him in his humanness. His human nature came over him and he realized that tonight is the night. Tonight is the night that I came into the world for. Did you know that in Passover there are four cups for the four different times that you drink? We don't necessarily celebrate that, but in Passover there's four cups, and those four different cups represent the four different promises that God made to the Israelites in Exodus 6. I will bring you out from under your yoke. I will set you free from slavery. I will redeem you. I will take you as my own. I will protect you. Jesus passed on this last cup. But did you know that there was a fifth cup? In Jeremiah, it is mentioned, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, said to me. Take from my hand this cup filled with the wine of my fury and give it to the nations to drink. David said in Psalms, he said, God, pour out your wrath on the nations that do not know you. It's the cup of wrath. It's the cup of hell itself. It's God's damnation. And the rabbis debated back and forth, do we put this cup in Passover? It's mentioned in the Bible. What do we do with it? And they went back and forth. You know, it does say that God's fury will be given to the nations to drink, those who refuse to acknowledge him. That's what he did to Pharaoh. So the rabbis argued and finally said, we can't solve it. And so they actually said, let's just leave it to when Elijah returns and we'll let him decide. So today it's known as Elijah's coming, but then it was Elijah's cup. And it was going to be decided by Elijah when he finally came back, and he would decide what would happen with that cup. So we're going back to the garden. Jesus in the garden. He's distressed. He's troubled. And I think that as he's laying beside an old olive tree, he began to think about that cup that God would one day pour onto the nations. I think that in his humanness, as he wrestled in the garden that night, it dawned upon him, I have to drink it. No, no, not that cup. Take that cup from me. No, I can't. But if you want me to, I will. and he drank it. Every drop, look. He drank it all. For you and for me, he drank it all. My God, why have you forsaken me? In John 19, he cries out, it is finished, as he drinks the last drops. He did it for us. So there he lay, praying to God, and his father said, I'm sorry, but there's no protection for you tonight. The angel of death would come, and there was no sacrifice for Jesus. There was no blood on the doorposts. I think that this, as this is, you know, as this is happening, to this point, Jesus has never been separated from the Father. To this point in time, he's never had, he's never not been in direct communion and relationship with the Father. And at this point, that is broken, that is separated. In a sense, all of Scripture rests on this point. Him drinking the cup for us. There's nothing left that you or I can do because he took it all. He drank it all. Every drop. So this morning, as we are taking communion, I think we're going to do one more song. Actually, we'll just receive communion right now together. There's two cups. The bottom cup has the bread. So the bread represents his body that was broken for us, that was beaten for us. Lord, we take this in remembrance of you. And the juice represents his blood that was shed for us. He drank it all. So in worship this morning, let's all stand again and worship him. And in our worship, let's express the gratitude that we have for the work that he did for us. It was our cup to drink. It was our responsibility. And he took it all.
Thank you. will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should
Father God, we just praise You this morning, Lord. We thank You for sending Your Son Jesus to die on the cross for us. We thank You for this moment that we have to worship You, Lord. Let our hearts and our minds be pleasing before You. Let our thoughts be upon the things that You've brought to us today, Lord. Let us hear from You. Lord, let our spirit be in alignment with Yours. Lord, we want to be filled with Your Holy Spirit, Lord. We don't want to be outside of Your will or Your way. Lord, we are ready to receive all that You have for us this morning, Lord. We trust You. We give You the rest of the service, Father. In Your name we pray. Amen. Real quick, would you guys put your hands together for the Lord? Through that whole service, I just wanted to clap my hands for what Jesus did. So I was like, I just need to do it. I didn't want to be the only one. Just thinking about what Stephen shared, the context of what Jesus was going through in that moment, it's heavy. It's kind of a lot, but it actually really relates really well to our scripture and our time this morning in this section of Acts. Paul himself goes through some serious valleys, some serious challenge, and we're going to kind of experience some of that this morning, and I just wanted to remind everybody, as we're going through this, the Lord has given me the focus of we are to grow from the knowledge that His Word is giving us. It's to challenge us, but it's also to shape us. How many of us want to be a beautiful prism or a gemstone that God has shaped and not just some rock that's inside of it, some beautiful thing, right? This is to shape us. And when we read scriptures like we're going to read today, or we hear like what Jesus had to do, these things should affect us to our nature. And I think what God is asking of us is to listen and be available. What does available look like for you in your life? What does making time for what God wants in the next season look like for you in your life right where you're at today? Paul knew, you guys remember, two chapters ago, Paul knew that when he went back to Jerusalem, he was going to be imprisoned and chained. He had no idea for how long. He didn't know what was going to happen. And then after it happens, after he's faithful, he says, I will go even unto death if I have to, because this is what the Lord has put on my heart. The Holy Spirit warned him. It was in preparation, remember, for the hard things he was going to go into. It's okay. He was ready. I'm asking you guys, not because I feel like you're Paul, not because I feel like I'm Paul, but because there's a season right now where the Lord is doing something in us in preparation for the next. Are you preparing? Are you ready? Are you willing to make room, make margin, make time for the Lord? I think the awesome message we had last week from Janet, just sharing in Corinthians there, like Paul did, he, this constant framework of understanding. We need to be building onto the foundation that the Lord has given us. We need to be growing into the next thing. We're in our discipleship stuff here at church, we like to talk about different things, different shapes. We apply scriptures and shapes and our testimony, our story, what God has done to really help people come out and learn things, right? But as I started this morning, the thing that was just on my heart is I need you guys to understand that seeking the Father's will is the number one thing we have to focus on. If we don't have our uptime with the Father, seeking God's will, are we ever going to do the right thing? We're going to do our will. We're going to do our thing. We will never do the will of the Father. And remember, from the very beginning, when I got the message in the middle of the night, the Lord told me we are to be family and build family. And the family of God are those who do the will of the Father. So if we don't spend time asking the Father, seeking Him, what His will is for us in these days, are we truly being His family? It's a challenge. We seek. Now we need to learn what that means. To after the Lord is speaking to us, He might give us something. We don't fully understand what that fully looks like. We need to seek learning and make the hardest thing. I'll speak this as us as Americans, okay? The hardest thing for us in our life right now is learning how to make time and room to obey. Who can relate with that? Our schedules are dedicated out way in advance, and we're so quick to feel like it's important for us. As long as we're busy, it's good. Is it the Father's will? That's the other side of that. As we learn to seek God, as we learn to listen and make more room for what God's doing and prepare and have these things happening in us, the natural effect is going to be sharing. That's that up in and out triangle. It's our heart of what God's doing is to give that to somebody else. That's the question this morning. Before I start, this is an opportunity for you to have self-evaluation. I'm going to share this again at the very end, but I just know that this is a framework. As we look at Paul's testimonies, we look at these stories, am I listening? Am I ready to do what God's asking? Am I seeking Him? Or am I comfortable being right where I am and doing my will? All right, I'm going to start here in Acts chapter 24. Remember, the governor ordered him, kept at Herod's headquarters, and he was going to appear before Felix now. So he was imprisoned. He escaped the murdering threat that they had. They had plans to kill him on the way. He's actually under lock and key, under guard, and actually secure and safe because of that. So 5 days later, Ananias, the high priest, arrived with some of the Jewish elders and the lawyer. I don't know how to say his name. It's pretty cool. To present their case against Paul, the governor. When Paul was called in, Tertullus presented the charges against Paul in the following address to the governor. You have provided a long period of peace for us Jews in the foresight, having enacted reforms for us. And with foresight, having enacted reforms for us. For all this, Your Excellency, we are so very grateful to You. But I don't want to bore you, so please give me your attention for only a moment. Does it sound kind of like what we heard before? This pompous wind, like building up for intentional. We just kind of see it. It's real quick. We have found this man to be a troublemaker who is constantly stirring up riots among the Jews all over the world. He's a ringleader of the cult known as the Nazarenes. He didn't even want to give it the real title. I like that. I don't know if you guys understand. They were known as the Way. And kind of interesting. Furthermore, he was trying to desecrate the temple when we arrested him. You can find out the truth of our accusations by examining him yourself. Then the other Jews chimed in, declaring that everything he said was true. Verse 10, the governor then motioned for Paul to speak. Paul said, I know, sir, that you have been a judge of Jewish affairs for many years, so I gladly present my defense before you. You can quickly discover that I arrived in Jerusalem no more than 12 days ago to worship at the temple. My accusers never found me arguing with anyone in the temple, nor stirring up a riot in any synagogue or on the streets of the city. These men cannot prove the things they accuse me of doing. Verse 14, but I admit that I follow the Way, which they call a cult. I worship the God of our ancestors, and I firmly believe the Jewish law and everything written in the prophets. I have the same hope in God that these men have, that He will raise both the righteous and the unrighteous. Because of this, I always try to maintain a clear conscience before God and all people. I like what Paul says there. I try to maintain a clear conscience before the Father, before God, and before all people, living right in the ways of the Lord and right in the ways in front of people. That's kind of a high calling. It's a hard thing to do. Verse 17, After several years away, I returned to Jerusalem with money to aid my people and to offer sacrifices to God. My accusers saw me in the temple as I was completing a purification ceremony. There was no crowd around me and no rioting, but some Jews from the province of Asia were there. And they and they ought to be here bringing charges if they have anything against me. Ask these men here what crime the Jewish High Council found me guilty of. Except for the one time I shouted out, I am on trial before you today because I believe in the resurrection of the dead. Verse 22. At that point, Felix, who was quite familiar with the way, adjourned the hearing and said, wait until Lysias, the garrison commander, arrives. Then I will decide the case. He ordered an officer to keep Paul in custody, but give him some freedom and allow his friends to visit him and take care of his needs. So what we're seeing right here is Governor Felix already has some familiarity with this way, more than the last situation. And there's already a consensus of maybe not everything that's being given to me is the truth, which is a good thing. So God knows specifically what his plan is. Remember, we read last week that, or 2 weeks ago, that his plan is to send him to all of Rome and share this gospel message. What Jesus did to the highest of high in Rome. We know that eventually he's going to go before Caesar. We know that there's going to be an opportunity for all to know of this Jesus and what he did in the most prominent ruling group in the world at that time. They needed to know. It wasn't just for the Jews anymore. The Gentiles. After a few days later, Felix came back with his wife, Drusilla, who was Jewish. Sending for Paul, they listened as he told them about faith in Christ Jesus, and he reasoned with them about righteousness and self-control and the coming day of judgment. Felix became frightened. Go away for now, he replied. When it's more convenient, I will call for you again. He also hoped that Paul would bribe him, so he sent for him quite often to talk to him. I'm going to pause right here. We see this interesting start happening, a relationship forming. And first off, he's afraid of the truth. How many of us have heard things about what God says is true, and it kind of scared us, especially in our infancy and our childlike faith, right? I mean, there's some things that God might call us to that doesn't sound very exciting, like being imprisoned and boiled with oil. Just because it's happened to somebody else doesn't mean it can't happen to us, right? No, I am very interested to hear what God is doing in your hearts. And I pray that over this next season, I'm just going to get more and more opportunity to hear what happens with you guys as you are being challenged, being raised up, being called up by God for the next season of call. You guys heard about the couple that's doing the missionary work in Spain that we just prayed about before service, right? I got an opportunity to sit down with them as they passed through town. They didn't call us ahead of time. I just happened to be here, and I took them to lunch, and I got to hear their story and what God was doing. And it's not rare, but it's not all the time that somebody that shows up at the church doesn't just need something from Pastor Luke or need something from the church. They were here on their way through and just thought they could be an encouragement to us and wanted to share with us who they were. But I was blessed. I was blessed by their heart, by their faithfulness and their diligence, and also when I knew their story, their obedience to what God had done. They had been in Florida for the last 15 years planting churches, and they had planted, I think, 10 churches in 15 years. Think about how much faith that takes to raise up a group of people and then let them grow and step onto the next thing. Not everybody has that call, but I was just amazed by that. They were planting all their families over there. They migrated from there. To there. And it's just an interesting thing. In their heart, they were planning on retiring there, close to their kids and their grandkids. And all of a sudden, when things looked like it was the right time and they had everybody close, the Lord called. And his heart all of a sudden was turned back to Spain, his home country, which his family had left a whole generation before he was even had the opportunity to know them. And the Lord starts turning him towards Spain. And he finds out that there was no Church of God anywhere in that country. That's one of the few. Kind of interesting. So he starts praying. And then the Church of God ministry says, hey, you're our guy. You've planted 10 churches. You have the language. You have the background. We're sending you. And he was at a place in his life where he was thinking about changing focus onto other things and participating at a different level. That was 5 years ago. And he's planted a church over there. And they don't, in Spain, they don't like, the Catholic Church in Spain has all the control. I'll just say it like that. Anything that is opposing doesn't get any kind of leverage, and they have a really hard time of certain things, and so they won't even let them buy property to build a church or to have a church that's not Catholic. It's very interesting. So he's got an amazing home church going on, an underground church, and it's pretty cool. Not because they can't meet, but just because they don't have the resources to meet out in that. But I was just blessed by this man at his age that had a heart to say yes to the Lord. Sometimes we need to be reminded that there's still people out there saying yes, right? If he can say yes and she can say yes and leave their 14 great-grandkids and all their grandkids, can we say yes to whatever God's calling us to? Maybe it's just to come up and share a word in front of the church like my brother did this morning. Whatever God is calling us to, he'll prepare us for. And I promise you, the word of God does not come back void. The reason why Paul was going to go share to everybody he was supposed to share to is because it was not going to come back void. These lives that God was reaching had a purpose. We can't see the purpose of all those things in this scripture because this is the story of Paul, these things. Do we know how every one of these people that heard these stories, how it affected their lives? No, but we see the kind of the result to us today. This story is still here 2,000 years later. To us, the truth of who he is and what he's done. After 2 years went by, verse 27, in this way, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus, Governor Festus. And because Felix had wanted to gain favor with the Jewish people, he left Paul in prison. So he starts meeting, 12 days after he's over there, turns into 2 years in prison. How are you guys going to handle being put in prison by a misunderstanding? Are you willing to keep ministering and witnessing to that husband and wife and these things for 2 years or whatever it is that God sends us to? He knows that he can trust the Lord. Paul spent 12 or 13 years, some say 14 years, being ministered to by the Holy Spirit in preparation. Being not just, he grew up in the rabbinical church or, you know, the Sadducee way, but he had to reprogram into the Holy Spirit's call and who Jesus was and what God was calling him to, not the religiousness of the law. He knew the law, but it took a long time for him to change some things. Can I ask you guys this question? Do you guys put people in a hard place sometimes because you don't see change fast enough? I'm going to be honest with you. Sometimes it takes time. What I talked about there at the beginning, having this heart to make room to learn to obey. Some of us don't make the margin, so it takes a lot longer to become fully surrendered to the Lord. There's things in us right now in our lives that are good things that are an absolute trap from the devil. And if we don't recognize them as that and don't cut them out of our life or use them for the purpose they're to be used for instead of the comfort that they're supposed that we take them as, we cause ourselves stumbling. We stop the work of God sometimes in our life. I like Paul's testimony. He's got all these years of understanding. He was as zealous as they come. That guy was radical. And then he's gone from the scene for a while. Do you think most people with his background, with his passion and zeal, would have come right back? Okay, I know who Jesus is. Let's go. Been right in the middle of it. You know what actually needed to happen? People had to hear testimony of who Paul had become, or they'd have been too afraid to let him be around them. Are there things about your past that people don't understand that maybe they need to see the change in you over time, and that testimony of what God's done and is doing needs to grow far enough to where you can witness and minister to those that you would want to, that if you tried to shortcut things, it might not work? You guys know what I'm talking about. Your family, your friends, your coworkers, your associations, no matter who they are that God's sending you to reach, need to see the evidence of Christ in you, not the information of who God is in you. What does the evidence of Christ look like in you? What is the gifts of the Spirit manifesting in your life look like? What are the changes of your heart, your direction, your call, and your motive look like for each and every one of us? It's going to be such a difference. I don't know if I would have handled it very well, being in prison for 2 years under a false pretenses, and all he has to do is make judgment, let's figure this out, move forward. But God knew, and he was waiting. He was standing with the Lord in that. So let's go to chapter 25. Let's read a little bit forward here. Actually, before I go there, 1 Peter 4. Let's read 1 Peter 4. It's going to come up here. Sorry. 1 Peter 4. Dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery trials you are going through as if someone, if something strange were happening to you. Instead, be very glad. Hold on. Very glad. Not just, you know, hopeful. Very glad. For these trials make you partners with Christ in his suffering so that you will have the wonderful joy of seeing his glory when it is revealed to all the world. You guys realize that that's going to happen? He's going to be revealed to all the world. He's who he is by us is being revealed all the time. But this is going to come at a certain point when every knee will bow, every tongue will confess who Christ is. If you are insulted because you bear the name of Christ, if you are, you will be blessed, for the glorious Spirit of God rests upon you. If you suffer, however, it must not be for murder or stealing or making trouble or prying into other people's affairs. If we cause this other stuff in our life and we call that our suffering, is that suffering for the name of Christ? No, we are to be living above reproach in those things, and we are to become righteous like Christ. And our likeness of Christ is what people are going to hate about us. Not because we learn to be busybodies and are nosy and in our family's business and gossips and all those different things, right? But it is no shame to suffer for being a Christian. Praise God for the privilege of being called by his name. For the time has come for judgment, and it must begin with God's household. And if judgment begins with us, what a terrible fate awaits those who have never obeyed God's good news. And also, if the righteous are barely saved, what will happen to the godless sinners? So if you are suffering in a manner that pleases God, keep on doing what is right and trust your lives to the God who created you, for he will never fail you. I don't know about you guys, but perspective, big picture, kingdom of God focus is what my head has to be, or I'm just totally not doing the things I'm supposed to be doing. How many of us get trapped a little bit in the things that are around us or so easily ensnared by worldly things? I'm going to read chapter 25 of Acts, part of it. 3 days after Festus, the new governor, arrives in Caesarea to take over his new responsibilities, he left for Jerusalem. So he arrives and then heads right to Jerusalem to deal with his things. He's going to take his role seriously. He is known as a good governor and a good man. The previous one was a wicked man, had all kinds of different things. If you start looking up history of him, there's plenty out there of who he was and what he was. He loved bribes. He loved his position. He was, and even in the Roman culture, those things didn't handle very well over time because it would cause uprisings and problems for the Romans. So they would remove him after a certain amount of time. Sorry. Where the leading priests and other Jewish leaders met him with and made their accusations against Paul. Sorry, verse 3. They asked Festus as a favor to transfer Paul to Jerusalem, again planning to ambush and kill him on the way. But Festus replied that Paul was at Caesarea, and he himself would be returning there soon. So he said, those of you in authority can return with me. If Paul has done anything wrong, you can make your accusations. He's already got a little insight. He's already got a little wisdom. God's already using him. This is something that is part of God's plan. One of the things that I remember being frustrated with most in my youth, in my younger years, was how quick I wanted things to happen and how slow things took. You guys can relate. Who can relate with me? Raise your hands. That's a nature in us that's not godly, is it? It's our flesh. And I mean, even if it's just healing from things or whatever, it doesn't matter what it is. We want quick results so that we're moving past that and onto the next thing. And sometimes we try to take shortcuts so much to the point we don't actually gain what we're supposed to gain out of the experience that we're having. Paul's not that way, though. He had plenty of time. Verse 6, about 8 or 10 days later, Festus returned to Caesarea. And on the following day, he took his seat in the court and ordered that Paul be brought in. When Paul arrived, Jewish leaders from Jerusalem gathered around and made many serious accusations. that the ones that they could prove or try to prove. 8, Paul denied the charges. I am not guilty of any crime against the Jewish laws or the temple or the Roman government, he said. Then Festus, wanting to please the Jews, asked him, are you willing to go to Jerusalem and stand trial before me there? Verse 10, but Paul replied, no, this is the official Roman court, so I ought to be tried right here. He was putting authority back in the Roman court, not in the Jewish court. You know very well I am not guilty of harming the Jews. If I have done something worthy of death, I don't refuse to die. But if I am innocent, no one has the right to turn me over to see these men kill me. I appeal to Caesar. Verse 12, Festus conferred with his advisors and then replied, very well, you have appealed to Caesar, and to Caesar you will go. Verse 13, a few days later, King Agrippa arrived with his sister Bernice to pay their respects to Festus, the new governor, and his new position and authority right in that region. This king, this is Luke now, I'm not reading up there. He has opportunity to even speak. I just see how God works all these little things. This is a big deal. Verse 14, during their stay of several days, Festus discussed Paul's case with the king. There's a prisoner here, he told him, whose case was left for me by Felix. When I was in Jerusalem, the leading priests and Jewish elders pressed charges against him and asked me to condemn him. I pointed out to them that Roman law does not convict people without a trial. They must be given an opportunity to confront their accusers and defend themselves. When his accusers came here for the trial, I didn't delay. I called the case the very next day and ordered Paul brought in. But the accusations made against him weren't of any crimes that I expected. Instead, it was of something about their religion and a dead man named Jesus, who Paul insists is alive. I kind of like the context here. I was at a loss to know how to investigate these things, so I asked him whether he would be willing to stand trial on these charges in Jerusalem. But Paul appealed to have his case decided by the emperor. So I ordered that he be held in custody until I could arrange to send him to Caesar. I'd like to hear the man myself, Agrippa said. And Festus replied, you will tomorrow. We're going to stop there in this part of the story. One of the things that God is doing is preparing hearts and understanding to hear the word. Hear who Jesus was, who these things are. One of the things that I've had happen 2 or 3 times around me in the last month and a half is somebody says something, somebody else is confirming it with the Holy Spirit's, you know, it's happening. I'm hearing the same things multiple times. How many of you guys can relate to what I'm talking about? Lots of confirmation of the Holy Spirit doing these things. How many of us, I asked this question before, but how many of us won't actually act until we've heard it multiple times from the Lord? Kind of a rebellious spirit in us a little bit, but it can be a nature. God will give us what we need, but at a certain point when you know and you're choosing to be rebellious, there will be a consequence for that. I like these sections of scripture stories about a man in his life and what God's doing and how he does these things, because it gives me hope that in every circumstance, God has a whole different way of doing things than I could even see the plan. So I don't have to be some, you know, strategist and figure things out. All I got to do is stand firm on God's word, stand on the truth, and be who he's called us to be. That makes it so much easier, isn't it? God's going to work things out. He'll do what he's planned. He'll teach us what we need to know. He'll give us the right words to say. When we go before the people that he's want to speak to, he will speak. The Holy Spirit will speak. Are you willing to go? Are you willing to say? I feel like there's a lot of changes happening in some of your guys' lives in this season. Who can kind of relate to me? Put your hand up if that's kind of going on in you. Lots of different changes, lots of things. I think it's God allowing you to have opportunity to make some margin, make some priority shifts, learning to make room for what God's asking us to prepare for and how we're to do it. First, to learn to obey. Stephen shared this morning in our time before communion, Jesus' flesh did not want to obey that because he knew what that was going to cost and what to feel that terror and anxiousness and that weight of the sin of the world and the wrath of God because of our sin, knowing that was going to be poured out on him. I am so grateful to know that I never have to suffer that, that I never have to feel that. At the day of judgment, the Lord Jesus Christ is going to go between me and the Father and say, this one is mine. I don't have to go before the Father in fear and terror and drink any part of that cup. I want that for all of you guys. I want your hearts to be assured in who you are in Christ and to not ever, you know, have that up and down of wonder. It's okay to have doubts here and there. It's okay. In our flesh, we're going to have doubts. We have plans and things, and maybe the Lord even gave us a direction. And I was thinking about Philip the other day, and he had the opportunity to go along and teach somebody that in Ethiopia some things, and that what happened with that man in Ethiopia. If you do a study of the Christians and those that the gospel in Ethiopia and how it spread, they have an older history of the Bible because of that touch right there than some of the stuff that we have right now. How cool is that? They have some interesting history of truth that God established in those places. It's the same thing. It's the same Bible. It's a word, but they have older manuscripts of it than some of the things that anybody likes to talk about. I got to saw it really. I follow podcasts. I listen to different things. I just like to be a watchman on the wall. I want to know what's going on. And I like to not be able to refute lies, but I like to understand the motive of a lie. Do you guys realize there's a lot of people out there that don't even know they're telling a lie? It's not really their fault because they just don't know. Ignorance is bliss in some situations, and some people just choose to stay ignorant. But the Lord is calling us to know the truth. It's not okay anymore to pretend like we don't need to know. That's for somebody else. He wants us to know. He wants us to know what he's doing, what he's calling us to. He wants us to be able to love our people, love our families the way that Christ loved us. He wants us to be building family. It's encouraging the right things, not the wrong things. We can see that Paul's generous imprisonment in Caesarea was actually a providential provision of protective custody against the murderous intentions of the religious leaders. Sometimes leaders in high authority, including Caesar and these others that are even higher in this ranks as he goes up, their schedules and priorities are literally so much more important in their head than anything else. There was never going to be a time until it was 2 years later, or the next opportunity for these things to be seen. And God knew that he couldn't protect them in Jerusalem. So he put them in protective custody. I think that's an interesting way to look at this. How do you think Paul took it? I bet he felt that too when he kept hearing those threats and kept seeing the crazies from Asia. The province of Asia kept coming around trying to kill him. Let me ask you these questions right here, okay? This is self-reflective. I don't want to hear the answers given back. I just want you guys to hear these things, okay? And I can give these to you later. I don't have them up there because I didn't really want to have it be focused on. I want you to hear this. I'm going to say this to myself, but ask this question for yourself. Do I have a heart for the lost? How often do I share my faith? Am I willing to take risks for the kingdom? Risks such as social pressures or financial risks or different things for the kingdom of God. Are we willing to take risks for the kingdom? Do I have a vision for what God wants in my life? Do I even have a vision or a plan of what God's sending in what I'm doing? Am I proud of the gospel or ashamed? This one's a hard one. Am I a servant? A true servant? Do you serve and love in that way? The leader of everything, Jesus, came to serve. And he taught us that to be like him, we must serve. One of the hardest things in our religious culture and our church mindsets is to make time for non-Christian relationships. We get real comfortable and sometimes in our comfort, we don't have anybody we're supposed to be reaching with the gospel message to. Do I leave time for non-Christian relationships? Do I reach where God has given me influence to reach? That was one of the biggest things that God started doing for me all those years ago, was he gave me a heart for the lost. I started seeing people for who they were, and not because they were in some bad shape or some, you know, whatever. It was just that I saw them like God saw me. I was lost at one point. Do you have a heart for the lost? When we're living up in and out lives, or seeking God and learning what he's asking us to do, and then learning to share that, if we're leading lives in that manner, we're going to grow. He's going to move us. He's going to plant roots down deep. And the thing that he's doing around me is he's actually partnering with me with people, partnering me with those that God is doing that same thing in, and it's becoming a strong cord. You're not alone. How many of you guys need to hear that right now in this room? You are not alone. He's not forsaking you. He's doing this in a lot of people around you. Are you sharing? Are you in a place where you're ready to receive and partner with what God's doing? It's not my job to tell you what he's doing in you. It's my job to point at what his word says he's doing, and then it's your job to testify to what he's been doing and is doing in this season of growth. See what I'm saying? I love what God's doing in me, and I want him to be glorified. I love what he's doing in you guys, but it's going to be towards other people. It's never going to be just towards ourselves. Look this week for somebody to share your faith with. The word of God, this gospel message, will not come back void. Do not be deceived. It doesn't take a perfect speaker, somebody that has all the knowledge. It has to have a heart from God with love. It will be heard and it will come back in truth. I love you guys. I love what God's doing. Let's pray. I'm going to pray over us. I'm going to pray over this week. I'm going to pray. There's just some amazing things happening in us right now, and I just want to pray. Father, we just come before you thankful and grateful for your spirit, thankful for this church and for this season, thankful for the opportunities we have to partner with you in ministry. And Lord, I just ask a special blessing for our dear friends in Spain, as they head back after being required to be gone for 6 months on the visa exchange. Lord, I ask right now that you would prepare them, equip them, encourage them, and strengthen them, Lord, for the return trip. And Lord, give them the faith to stand and equip them to raise up the generation of leaders that have been standing in the gap. Let them start the new things as well. Father God, I just pray right now over each and every person in this room that your word is being spoken to, that we would receive everything we need. Lord, that we would lay down the things that are a distraction to us and that we would pick up the things that you're calling us to be picking up. Lord, we want to glorify you and we want to bring all things at your footstep, like in before you, God. We don't want to tell you what we need to do, Lord. We want to hear from you what you want us to do. Lord, we want to humble ourselves before you. We want to know you and your will. Lord, forgive us of all unrighteousness. Forgive us of all wickedness and deceitful things. Lord, any motivations or ambitions that aren't of you in anything, Lord, we cut them down. We cast them down, Lord. We put them at your feet. Forgive us, Father, for those things. And let us be your people called by your name, ready to do your will. Lord Jesus, teach us what it means to follow after you and obey you. Teach us what it means to love our family the way you're calling us to love, not enable. Teach us to love our friends and coworkers in the way that you're calling us to love them. Lord, let us live righteously and be known as followers of the way. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we give you glory this morning. Lord, we ask that you would send your angels about us this week, protect us from the lies of the enemy and the attack of the enemy. Lord, we know his game and his scheme is deviant and wicked. And Lord, we know that the lies that he brings are sometimes so conniving and tricking. Lord, we ask right now that we would stand on your truth and our identities would be in your word alone and who you've called us to be. Lord, let us not be deceived anymore. Let us not be dissuaded anymore. Let us not be put off anymore. Father, be glorified for your name's sake, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Even though we walk through the valley of the shadow. that's a reminder we need to hear these days, right? We need to it doesn't matter what it looks like. We're limited by these five senses, you know? Eyes don't work. Nose doesn't work. When you're not touching anything, it's not working. Why do we depend so much on our five senses to connect us to what's real, right? We know that they're fallible. So the things of the Spirit are like the wind, right? You don't see the wind itself, right? You see the leaves blowing. You see the effects of the wind blowing. You don't see the wind. The Spirit is like the wind, and no matter what, the wind is always there. It's always with us. Amen? He never lets go. Okay, you're dismissed. Have a wonderful rest of your Sunday. Thank you.